Hasdovic's online lecture series, lecture number 5, The Progressives. If you look in any dictionary under the word progressive, you will probably find one of these two definitions: someone who moves things forward, or someone who tries to make things better. The word applies to people throughout American history who have tried to do just that to our country, to move it forward, to try and improve it. The term was first applied to those Americans who, fresh off the demise of the Populist Party in the late 1890s, regrouped and reformed to confront the numerous problems created during the Gilded Age. Initially, the progressive label was one taken by Americans who wanted to clean up the corruption in politics, clean up the barbarous conditions factory workers had to contend with, and, in general, to clean up American society. Thanks in no small part to the rapid rate at which Americans started consuming newspapers, especially after the technological improvements in printing allowed for the easy reproduction of photographs and illustrations, more and more Americans latched onto the idea that America needed to be improved. In this lecture, we'll look at some of the many different faces of early progressivism in the late 19th and early 20th century, and the many varied and often controversial methods they used to attack corruption where they saw it. Through it all, you should be able to clearly see two common themes. Progressives were people who wanted to fix America in order to make it better, at least as they saw it. And that, like the populace before them, progressives are still alive and well. Part 1, Progressives in Politics. By the time that the Industrial Revolution was in full swing, it was clear that every level of America's political system was imbued with serious corruption. Most visible to Americans was the corruption within their own cities and towns, thanks to political machines. State-level politics seemed to be run by and for the wealth of industrialists. Even at the national level, our government had major flaws. At the local level, natural disasters, unfortunately, played a significant role in changing political systems. Floods like at Johnstown in 1889, Galveston, Texas in 1900, and Dayton, Ohio in 1913, as well as the Great Chicago Fire in 1871 and the San Francisco earthquake in 1906, showed just how poorly cities were prepared to face disaster. Now, as it so happened, these cities had measures to meet these disasters. There were fire departments, and there were supposedly contingency plans adopted for worst-case scenarios. However, a lot of funding that was supposed to go to these emergency projects never seemed to find its way out of the hands of crooked politicians or their cronies in industry. Furthermore, industrialists worked very hard to make sure that cities especially did not adopt laws that required buildings be constructed with safe, strong material, or even constructed with sufficient ventilation and sanitation in mind, let alone in consideration of the problems fires, floods, and earthquakes could pose. These things cost extra money, and if you were a contractor at this time, the more you spent on your project, the less you kept in your pockets. Fed up with how corrupt officials translated into tragically killed citizens, such as the 300 dead in the Chicago fire, 700 dead after the San Francisco quake, and 2,200 dead at Johnstown, which was the worst American disaster until 9/11, corrupt machine politicians were voted out of office, and in some cases, like Boss Tweed, even thrown into jail. Tougher voting laws were instituted with an aim at keeping new immigrants from voting, especially since they didn't know how voting worked in America, and were often political machines' chief source of support. City councils, who consisted of multiple members, were either replaced or worked in concert with mayors, spreading out the power of local governments, making them less prone to the corruption that came so easily when one person held all the political cards. At the state level, we see more of the progress made by early populists. While they failed to win the presidency, populists did succeed a great deal at winning a large number of local and state offices, even sending a few representatives and senators to Washington, D.C. before the end of the 1800s. Reform-minded politicians in the early 1900s, like Robert Fighting Bob La Follette and James S. Hogg, were popular enough to capture the governor's office in their states. In Wisconsin, La Follette was elected to 3 terms as governor, largely because of how he regulated industry in his state. Targeting the railroads, he successfully set up commissions to regulate the fares they charged, and forbade the railroads from giving state workers free passes. Hogg, a 1-term governor in Texas, kicked illegal insurance companies out of his state, regulated railroads, much like La Follette did, and championed laws that would break up monopolies. La Follette and Hogg claimed they were not anti-business, they simply wanted it out of politics. Taking a page out of the Populist Party platform of 1892, many states also adopted the initiative, recall, and referendum. The initiative allowed for citizens themselves to write legislation and put it up for vote on ballots. The referendum would allow voters to decide on whether or not that law should pass, not their own state legislators. The recall enabled voters to actually remove or fire public officials through the ballot. By 1920, 20 states had adopted at least one of these procedures. Most notably was California's adoption of the recall over 100 years ago, as we saw practiced earlier this decade when Governor Gray Davis was ousted by a recall vote, which then allowed Arnold Schwarzenegger to enter and win the race for the vacant California governor's chair. Nationally, two amendments were added to the Constitution in 1913, the 16th and 17th to be so added. The first since the Civil War amendments were added between 1865 and 1870. The 16th Amendment allowed the national government to collect income taxes, as long as they did so equally among all state citizens. Populists had been arguing for a national, graduated income tax to help redistribute some of the vast wealth the robber baron industrialists had made back among Americans in the form of social services. This amendment remains quite controversial, as the United States federal income tax is one of the most complex in the world. Our tax code alone stretches out over 500 pages in length and is much, much longer in comparison than the United States Constitution. It has hundreds of new rules and changes made annually. While the federal government does have a tool in its hand to use some of America's wealth for the benefit of all Americans, it's hardly what can be considered a graduated tax in the sense that the populace meant. Thanks to loopholes in the code, the wealthiest corporations and citizens often end up paying far less than even the average American middle-class taxpayer. It remains to be seen if our children will have an even more complex tax system to juggle, or whether more progress and reform will come to simplify it and make it more fair. The 17th Amendment had much more clear-cut effects. It mandated that our nation's senators be elected by state citizens. State legislatures commonly chose their senators themselves at this time, with no popular participation whatsoever in the process. The amendment also allowed governors to choose replacement senators if one from their state was to die, resign while in office, or, like President Obama, be elected to another office while serving. Illinois Governor Rod Blagojevich got into big trouble nationally when his remarks regarding putting President Obama's Senate seat up for sale to the highest bidder were made public. While definitely empowering the American voters who could now elect the senators and representatives who would make income tax laws, these amendments have their flaws. Further, they also gave the national government more power by removing powers from state governments, as well as more direct involvement in people's lives, either through how they were taxed or how their officials were chosen.